Hello everyone, I'm Sister Khaya. I will be presenting Module 2. The Module 2 is having Bedaquiline Substitution Overview. I've introduced this slide in the previous module, in Module 1, but what is very important is that this patient which is going to be on Bedaquiline, we still use the intensive phase and the continuation phase. And very, very important that when you started Bedaquiline, you have to finish 24 weeks of treatment, meaning that this patient has to be on Bedaquiline for 6 months, no matter at what month have you started the treatment. The Bedaquiline has to be continued for 24 weeks. You remember this slide I've introduced in the previous module, is just to stress the grouping by health organization. We've got group A, which is fluoroquinolones, group B, second line, injectables, and group C, other co-agents, group D, add-on agents, but very, very important to look at group D2, which is having Bedaquiline and delamnid. Now, this patient, when you're going to be starting on Bedaquiline regimen, meaning now that this patient is not going to be started on moxifloxacilin. This patient has to be on levofloxacilin. At initiation, if you're going to be initiating this patient on Bedaquiline, you will start the patient on Bedaquiline as well as levofloxacilin. But if you started the patient at the initiation using kanamycin and the patient along the line start having some side effects, ototoxicity and nephrotoxicity, that's when now you're going to be switching the kanamycin. You will stop the kanamycin and substitute with the Bedaquiline. But with moxifloxacilin, you will switch to levofloxacilin. Very, very important. I've already introduced this slide previously that we're using the standard short course regimen, which is 9 to 12 months. Even if you're going to be using Bedaquiline, you will still use the standard short course regimen. This slide is a DRTB reflex slide, which means this patient, you've started using Uginexpect, and then along the line you have to, at baseline, you have to take the DRTB reflex. Very, very important to adhere to those principles of sputum collection because you want to confirm that this patient who was the rifampicin resistant, if is resistant to other drugs other than the rifampicin. Still very important on this one, interpretation of first line LPA results. The results will show us a mutation of the INHA mutation, meaning that this patient is also resistant to ethionamide. Now, this client is going to be initiated on high-dose isoniazid with other drugs of the standard short-course regimen, but you won't be using ethionamide. But if the client is having KG gene, I still repeat to say we're going to be still using the high-dose isoniazid despite that the patient is resistant to isoniazid. Then if the patient is showing INHA and KG gene mutation, that's the patient which is going to be channeled for Bedaquiline regimen, which is the one which I'm talking about right now. Now, remember, this slide is just a normal standard short course regimen that we talked about in Module 1, that this patient will be started on this regimen. Should this patient now start facing some side effects with this regimen, that's when the patient is going to be substituted with the Bedaquiline, which is the regimen which is also going to be on 9 to 12 months. Meaning that this patient, you will substitute kanamycin if the patient is having some challenges with kanamycin. Then if the patient from the beginning was having some problems with ototoxicity, this is the patient which is going to be started from the initiation using Bedaquiline substitution regimen. What we must understand about bedaquiline regimen is only for those patients which are facing some challenges or having some problems during initiation of a treatment. For example, if the patient is having ototoxicity at the beginning of the treatment, this patient will be started on bedaquiline. Or if along the line you started the kanamycin and the patient started having nephrototoxicity or ototoxicity, this patient is going to be substituted with bedaquiline. What we must understand is that this bedaquiline is containing regimen will only be implemented at the centers with access to the newer drugs, meaning that most of the centers at a decentralized site won't have these drugs, but centers of excellence are having bedaquiline. Then there's if the decentralized site is accredited to have bedaquiline as a bedaquiline site, then the patient will not be transferred to any other site. The drugs will be in the site and then the substitution will be done. Reasons for bedaquiline substitution I've already mentioned, that is ototoxicity, very, very important. Once the patient starts having tinnitus without hearing loss, some of the patient will even complain of some dizziness. You have to check hearing if it's okay. And then another thing, if there's nephrotoxicity or inability to tolerance injections, for example, psychosocial reason, abscesses, or severe pain when the patient is being given injections. Now, here is the bedaquiline regimen. The intensive phase is having bedaquiline and levofloxacin. Remember, I've mentioned that if the patient is going to be on bedaquiline, you don't start the patient on moxifloxacin. Instead, you use levofloxacin. So it will be bedaquiline, levofloxacin, clofazamine, ethionamide, parazinamide, high-dose INH, and ethambutol. And then in the continuation phase, levofloxacin, clofazamine, parazinamide, and ethambutol. Very, very important, once you've started bedaquiline, the patient has to finish 24 weeks of treatment. And we're still using a weight band for our patients. Remember, with bedaquiline, it's 400 milligrams daily for 2 weeks, then 200 milligrams three times a week. And this one, you have to do health education to the client so that he understands, because most of the DRTB drugs are taken daily. So once the client is being changed to three times a week, the client has to be notified and has to be educated on the times when is he going to be taking the treatment. Take a look at this slide. It's a very, very important slide for those patients which are having E. coli infection. For instance, this patient was on ARVs at the initiation of MDR-TB treatment. Remember, the drugs which we are using for our clients which are co-infected with no problems, we use the fixed dose combination. So now, if the client is on fixed dose combination, now you have to change the effervescence, because effervescence and bedaquiline, it's contraindicated. So this patient is going to be started on inavolisib, but you have to check the viral load of this client. If the viral load is undetectable and the CD4 count for women is less than 250 and in males is less than 400, it's okay, you will use the nevirapine. You will change your effervescence and to inavolisib within 7 days. But if the client now is having CD4, which is above 250 if it's a female, and the CD4 of 400 if it's above 400 and it's a male, be careful when you're going to be starting inavarapine because of a potential side effect of hepatotoxicity. So those are the clients which you might consider using a regimen to, which is having lopinavir. Look at this slide, which is showing us the drug interactions. Look at ibedaquiline. Very, very important. You can see that ibedaquiline and efavirenz is contraindicated when you're looking at the information on top there. Green means that there is no interaction. Yellow, you use that drug with caution. Red, there is interaction. And that dark brown color, meaning that this patient is having a drug-drug interaction, so you wouldn't be starting the efavirenz and bedaquiline at the same time. So you will change the client to unevarapine, as I've explained in the previous slide. Now, I've explained this slide in module one, but I will further explain now using the bedaquiline. See, when the patient is having a double mutation, very, very important, this is the patient which is going to be channeled for a bedaquiline substitution. And this client, remember that is not going to be on the standard short course regimen. Now this patient will be treated for 18 to 24 months. Then if the client is also having challenges with, is having resistance to fluoroquinolones as well as resistant to second line injectables, that's an XDR-TB client. That one, it needs to be transferred to centers of excellence. That's where they treat our XDRs at the moment. Monitoring and determining the duration of intensive phase in MDR-TB patient, we're still using the same as in the module one, meaning that if the client is having a smear which is negative at month one, you will carry on with the treatment and checking the smears, doing the cultures. If the smears are negative from baseline up to month four, you will stop the intensive phase and go to continued fringe phase at month five. And then you'll, again, if the smear is positive at baseline and then the smear becomes negative at month one, all is well for this client. And then at month four, you will stop the intensive phase and go to a continuation phase. Still, if the patient is having smears that are positive, month three and month four, that's where, as a clinician, you should start now being worried to check adherence, you check a clinical picture of the patient. If all is well, you do the DRTP reflex, you carry on with the treatment. If the smear at the month five is negative, then you will carry on to a continuation phase. But if at month six and month seven, the smear is still positive, this patient, meaning that it's failing the regimen, it has to be transferred to the centers of excellence if the patient is not already in the center of excellence, because this patient is already on ibedaquiline substitution substituted regimen. So what is important is that no matter at what month you've started ibedaquiline, you carry on for 24 months. This is an example of pill burden for MDR-TB patients which are having MDR-TB as well as HIV. You can see on the MDR-TB for this patient who is having a treatment on a standard short course regimen, who weighs above 70 kilograms. You can see how many tablets this patient takes. And then you go to on the other side where also the patient is HIV positive and also now is on ibedaquiline regimen. So even if he's on kanamycin or is on bedaquiline, there's still a pill burden. The patient at the end is taking a lot of tablets. That is why it's very, very important at the beginning of a treatment, anticipatory guidance is the key for these patients. You have to take the patient and do e-health education, also monitor side effects, and be with the patient at all the time. Try and listen to every side effect that the patient comes with so that you are able to make sure that the patient is taking the treatment at all the time. Thank you for listening, and these are the references that we've used for creating the slides.